Welcome at this webinar on e-commerce and customs declaration by Dutch Customs. My name is Albert Veenstra. I'm professor of trade and logistics at the Rotterdam School of Management in Rotterdam, and I will be the host for today. With me are two gentlemen from Dutch Customs that are going to explain to us what the developments are with regard to the EU VAT e-commerce package and the impact for business in Europe, in the Netherlands, but also the impact for customs. So first of all, we have Frank Heijman, who is head of trade relations. Welcome. And we have Han Bos, who is the strategic policy advisor for e-commerce of Dutch Customs. So Frank, as a brief introduction, head of trade relations, what does that mean?
Head of trade relations, I'm responsible for the National Committee on Trade Facilitation in the Netherlands. We've joined up the industry, different departments and different agencies that are involved in cross-border trade. And under the umbrella, as we call it, of the National Committee on Trade Facilitation, we discuss new legislation, implementation of legislation, and practical issues in the daily operations. And we want to optimize trade, and the parties that are involved today represent all the parties in the international supply chain.
Thank you. And Han, Strategic Policy Advisor e-commerce, what does that mean? What do you do in your daily work?
Yes, my daily work consists of two major components. The first one is a national component. It's all about thinking about strategy for the supervision on e-commerce consignments nowadays, but also in future with a lot of innovation techniques. The other component is the international one. I'm a participant of several project groups in Brussels, on the one hand for the European Commission and on the other hand for the World Customs Organization. And these project groups are all related to e-commerce.
Okay, thank you. So I will briefly explain what we are going to do for today. I will provide a brief discussion, a brief introduction of the context of e-commerce, and we'll have a look at a few polls to get a bit of a flavor of what audience we have in this webinar at the moment. And then we will go through three presentations from the gentlemen that I have just introduced. Who will talk to us about the legislation and the changes in the legislation, about the way Dutch Customs has decided to deal with the changes in that regulation, and finally the third presentation on how exactly the process of declaring e-commerce goods will develop over the next few years. And with that, we hope that you will get a good idea of what is happening and what is coming at you as a result of this new regulatory structure from the EU. After each of these blocks, we will have a Q&A session to clarify things that maybe weren't immediately clear. And we will have one or two polls after each block to track a bit our progress and to also satisfy our own curiosity on certain issues. We have a big Q&A session all the way at the end. So there we will have ample time for you to ask questions. These questions are moderated, so don't be upset if your question will not go through. We have a few hundred participants in this seminar, so obviously we have a moderation team that will select appropriate questions. But important questions that we don't have time for will definitely be dealt with later on. Thank you for that. Before we continue with the three presentations, as I said, I will just briefly sketch a few trends that will provide the context for this complicated topic of e-commerce. There's just a few things that I would like to say about this. One is an important feature of e-commerce around the world, and we're not talking only about the EU, but also Asia, also Africa, also the Americas. E-commerce is really strongly growing. It has been growing very rapidly for years now, and the end of this growth is not in sight. So this is immediately the first implication of e-commerce. It's a growing flow of trade. It's a complicated flow of trade because it's so fragmented, and the fact that it keeps on growing is really results in a burden for supervision agencies. What we will see particularly in Europe is that there are also shifts happening. Brexit will lead to a shift of the burden of e-commerce, partly from the UK to other countries, and in particular, I think, Belgium and the Netherlands within the EU. And there are other developments that will also realign the impact and the effort that needs to be spent on supervising e-commerce. So this is an additional aspect that is important to understand, I think. A second point to make here is that we are talking about a peculiar flow of goods. It's a very specific type of products. It's low value products, small packages. And one of the problems that is related to this is has to do with quality of products. We have a recent, fairly recent investigation from a Dutch agency on consumer protection, who have just bought a bunch of goods in Asia and verified these goods against the European norms for product quality and product safety, and they found a lot of problems. The numbers are maybe not that important, but a lot of these products have problems if you really look at what the rules are in Europe and how we think about product safety. And this means that even for low-value goods, supervision remains a very important job that our agencies need to be doing. And so this combination of the growth of the volumes, this combination of the volume but also of product safety means that we have to keep a certain level of supervision, custom supervision, product quality supervision in place just to keep our society protected. And that is, I think, the important context for why we are talking about policy making, about legislation for e-commerce, and some of the changes that we are going to discuss in this seminar. So I will stop here. Now, before we launch into this, into the three presentations that I promised you, we will briefly ask you a few questions. Our audience, we would like to know a few things about you, and we'll do that through three polls. And the first one of those is this poll, where we are looking into industry background. We would like to get a flavor of the type of organizations that we have currently in our audience. So while we are looking, and we'll give you a minute or two to press the buttons, let me quickly go to Frank. Frank, you are head of trade relations, and you already explained what this is about. Does this poll reflect more or less the spread of companies and organizations that you are commonly talking to?
Yes, indeed. The webinar today is open for the industry and for customs officers as well. And looking at the industry, we see that indeed customs brokers, they are a member of our National Committee on Trade Facilitation. The FENAX is the Dutch organization for custom brokers and for logistics, are a very important member. We also have EVO FENEDAX. These are the shippers in the Netherlands, so the importers. We have the exporters present. But there's also a group of companies that is not traditionally a member of our National Committee on Trade Facilitation. And these are actually the platforms. They create this new industry. The B2C shipments, they go alongside, let's say, the vested industry, and platforms were not our partners at the table. And recently, because of all the changes, but also because of the increase of e-commerce trade, we decided that under the umbrella of the National Committee on Trade Facilitation, we start a new discussion group specifically on e-commerce, where the vested industry will be invited, so the trade associations that already are at our table, but also the new integrators, the declaration service providers, and the platforms. And we will launch this somewhere in the next month. And in particular, towards the implementation and the entering into force of the new legislation, we want to discuss with that specific industry the specific topics and the problems and the challenges that we all face. So in that sense, it represents our industry, but not completely covering what we do nowadays in the National Committee on Trade Facilitation.
Okay, so let's have a look at the results. I think we have 301 people answering the poll. So there is about 36% from customs administration, I guess colleagues who are looking at how you're doing. Hopefully also some colleagues from other customs agencies in the rest of Europe. We see 14% customs brokers, customs agents. I can imagine that these are particularly interested in this seminar. Also a large other category, by the way, about 21%. I guess this includes academics, for instance, shippers, 11% logistics and postal service providers. Yeah, so it's an interesting mix of participants in this webinar. Let me go to the second poll. Put the question up here before I start the poll. So the second poll is about where are you coming from? What country? What background? And nation internationally. And we'll wait for the. So Han, maybe a question to you. Do you expect an audience also from outside the Netherlands for this webinar? We're talking in English. I guess that's already answering the question to some extent.
Yeah, for sure. We have some participants, colleagues from all over the world. So at least I receive reactions from them to participate. But we also see a business side from other parts of the world. So the bigger platforms, etc., they are not all stated in the Netherlands or in Europe. So yes, I think we have colleagues, but also a business as well on a global level, yes.
Yeah. So I see there are still some answers being given for the poll. Slightly more people than the previous one, so I guess all of you are getting to know the buttons and the mechanisms. I will stop here for now. We are 79%. I'm reading that correctly. Dutch, but also people from Belgium, from Germany, from France, from other EU, from the UK. We single them out nowadays, I guess, and that makes a lot of sense. But also 3% non-EU. So I guess there will be some Chinese people watching this webinar, some people from Singapore, other Asian countries, perhaps also the US. So we have quite a nice international audience. I will stop this poll, have a final look at the results. We had so I said 79, it was reduced to 78, as some more international people clicked. So very nice international audience, as I already mentioned. And then the final poll, this is a question we would like to ask you. It's a sort of an a priori question. We would like to know your opinion, your understanding, evaluation about the current state of affairs with regard to the legislation on e-commerce. So this poll reflects that. The question is, how do you rate the new legislation on e-commerce for VAT and customs? And let's see what our audience says here. We will have this same question popping up later on after you've heard the presentations, so we can see if you have been enlightened by us and by this webinar. But let's see for the moment what answers are coming in. It's sort of more or less equal. The don't know answer is 43% at the moment, and there is an even distribution between adequate and inadequate. So I think that's why people tune into this webinar, obviously, because they don't know and they are expecting to hear our explanation. Let's see, it's still running. I could ask these two gentlemen what they think of the legislation, but you will hear from them in a minute, right? So that's maybe. I see the percentage don't know creeping up a little bit. So maybe that's a good moment to stop and have a look at the results display, so the audience can also see what the outcome is. So as I said, 44%, so quite a large group of people are still a little bit, well, in the dark, maybe. Mm-hmm. Looking for answers, looking for information. So let's not keep them too much then. I will go back to the polls. So without further ado, thank you very much for answering those polls. We will go to our first presentation by Han Bos to introduce the new EU legislation on VAT e-commerce.
Okay. Yes, thank you. So, yes, I want to explain in this part the VAT e-commerce package from the EU. This package is decided in December 2017, and it's a very broad package with a lot of measures, all VAT related. And today we scope to the customs ones. So we are looking to all these measures which are related to customs. These measures will go into place from the 1st of July next year. So we still have half year to go, but in e-commerce, half year is a very short time frame. So it's good to understand what is happening and what the consequences are of these new measures. So let's start with the introduction of a few new elements in this legislation. And there are three really new ones. The first one is the official announcement, the special scheme for distance sales of goods imported from third countries, so from the non-EU countries. This is called the IOS, the Import One-Stop Shop. And for the rest of this seminar, I will talk about IOS and etc. also special arrangements. So I will use the term which some of you already know. And later on, I will also explain what the typical elements of IOS are. The second new element is the special arrangement for the declaration and payment of the import VAT. That's called briefly special arrangement. So that's rather a different one than the first. And later on, I will explain you what kind of elements are in this special arrangement and how is this different from the IOS, the first one. Third new element is specific data set for low value shipments. So this is called the super reduced data set. So it means that in a normal declaration, you have round and about 60 data elements to lodge towards customs. In this super reduced data set, we are talking about 30 data elements. So roughly said, 50% of a normal declaration. These three new elements, they are not mandatory. So these are on top of everything that we already have. So when you say, okay, I'm very pleased with the way of working I do nowadays, and I have a lot of experience, and I don't want to change my IT environment regarding these new ones, it's okay. It's up to you to decide where you choose. So when you say, I don't like the IOS, I don't like the special arrangement, no problem at all. There must be a declaration, but you can do it the way you do it nowadays. The same for the super reduced data set. When you say, okay, I'm already used to lodging declarations with the complete data set, you can continue. But when you say, no, I want less burden, I want only half of them to be lodged, then you can make the choice for the super reduced data set. Then we go to some other changes. From the 1st of July next year, we see the abolition of the VAT exemption for the import of non-EU shipments with an intrinsic value of maximum €22. I think most of you know the existence of this exemption, and this exemption is rather not in favor with the EU business partners, because they stated in Brussels, the Commission, that there is a difference when we're talking about these kind of goods, so below the €22. Because buying a product for €15 in the EU means that I must pay the VAT nowadays. Buying the same product outside the EU, I don't have to pay this VAT because there is the exemption of this €22. So there is not a level playing field when you look to a EU business and non-EU business. So the Commission said, let's create this level playing field from the 1st of July, so this exemption is abolished. Another element is the obligation to submit an electronic import declarations to customs for all goods. Perhaps you say that's nothing new, because there is already mandatory to lodge electronic import declarations, but it's allowed to lodge oral declarations or by any other act for goods below 22 euro. And some actors do. So they are not, it's not illegal what they are doing, it's allowed, but from the 1st of July, everyone has to lodge an electronic declaration. Also for the goods below 22 euro. So from the first euro on, we will receive electronic declarations. The last one, and that's a pretty important one, and we think with a lot of consequences. There is the obligation to submit the declaration in the country of destination. Again, we are talking about the VET. Yes, so and one of the meanings of the VET is that you must pay the VET in the country of destination. And with this new paragraph and an already existing article, we will tell you later on more exactly about this, is this obligation created. The only exception is when you use the IELTS. So when you use the import one-stop shop, you don't have the obligation to lodge the declaration in the country of destination. But in all other cases, you do. So this will have consequences for customs in the Netherlands, but also for customs in other member states, but for sure also in the logistic world. Because nowadays, a lot of decisions are made otherwise. Okay, so these are the new elements in this VET package, which will have consequences for customs and business. So we talked already about the IOS and this special arrangement, and here you will see some criteria. So it's not that you can use the IOS and the special arrangement for all kinds of goods. Yes? So here we see there must be, we must speak about the distance sale of non-EU goods. So goods from outside the EU. And distance sales, they are defined in this VET directive from the EU. So there can be any mistake about what it should mean. Yes, so sellings, distance sellings from outside the EU to the EU. Then we see that there is a maximum to the value, a maximum of 150 euro for the intrinsic value. And there is always discussion going on about intrinsic value. And the Commission is there now very clear about it. There is a new paragraph in the legislation which defines this intrinsic value. And roughly said, it means that intrinsic value is the value of the products themselves, without any cost for insurance, freight, etc. Yes, but it's one criteria. These costs must be specified on an invoice or on a document, so it must be clear what part of the cost is for the goods and which part is for the costs. And last but not least, within the IOS and the special arrangement, it is not allowed to declare excise goods. Yes, so when you look into the legislation, this VET directive from the EU, and you look to Article 369, there are two chapters in this article because it's a very big one. Two chapters are important, Chapter 6 for the IOS and Chapter 7 for the special arrangement. And when you look into these chapters, you see that the excise goods are examined. So you can't use excise goods in combination with IOS and special arrangement. Yes? So these three criteria together must be fulfilled. And then you say, when you can say yes to these three criteria, you can say yes to the IOS or the special arrangement. But again, it's not mandatory. Yes? Okay, so these are the criteria. Then let's talk about how does it work. Because the first time I heard about the IELTS, I didn't know what was going about. So I think it's good to have some few minutes to pay attention to the topics, the typical elements of this IOS. It starts with a registration. And the registration means that you go to the tax authorities and you can ask for a registration for the IOS. And here it's mentioned directly or indirectly. It means that a non-EU seller can register for the IOS, him or herself, but there must be an establishment of this company in the EU, or he can do it, let's do it for the by the platform, so when the platform is involved, so the sellings are all realized by the interference of a platform, then it's the possibility for the platform also to register for the IOS. So that's more or less an indirect registration. Mind you, it's a single choice. So you can't say, today I'm in for the IOS, tomorrow I'm out and I'm using a special arrangement, or the day after I'm using the normal procedure. No. When you say yes to the IOS, it means that all your sellings, non-EU sellings to here, will go via this IOS. During this registration, you receive a number, an IOS VET number, and this number is very important, and I will tell you later on. The second step is that a private person from home or wherever, he orders a good. Yes, so via the internet, there's an order is placed, and here you see, and it's a big difference with what's happening nowadays, that at the moment of ordering the good, you have to pay the VAT. So the VAT is paid to the platform or the non-EU seller all over the world. So this VAT leaves, in this example, the Netherlands, and goes to China, United States, whatever. Second step, third step. After the ordering of the goods will come into Europe. Let's say they come via Schiphol Airport into the Netherlands. Then an import declaration must be lodged. As already stated before, it's from the 1st of July mandatory to lodge a digital one, so an electronic import declaration. And because the fact that you already paid the VAT at the moment of ordering the goods, you don't have to pay the VAT at import. Yes, so there is an exemption. But this exemption, before we give this exemption, we do some checks. So customs, point four, will perform some checks at the import moment. So we are looking to this IOS registration. So the number we talked about in stage one is an element of this declaration. One of the data elements is the VAT IOS number. And customs will check from every declaration this number. It's a complete automated check, at least in the Netherlands. So we can, in a very quick response, we will get a signal from Brussels, from a central database, whether an IOS number is valid, yes or no. When it's valid, it's okay. When it's not valid, we will refuse this declaration. And you will not receive the exemption of the import VAT. We will also check the value of the goods, intrinsic value, not above 150 euro. We will look to the goods if we think that there is a reason to do, no excise goods, etc. After this, and that's also new regarding to the way of working nowadays, step five, there must be lodged a monthly VAT declaration to the tax administration. So not customs, because you already lodged import declarations to customs. But this VAT, which you paid in step two, which went to China or the United States, this has been come together on a monthly basis, and this non-EU seller or this platform, so the one with this IOS number, has to lodge this declaration. Monthly basis done to the tax administration. And in this declaration, there is a total amount of VAT of the previous month of all the sellings to all the member states in the EU. So it's a compromised declaration. And to this declaration, there's an attachment. And in this attachment is written down how the country, the member state of registration, should divide this total amount of the VET over the member states. Yes, so the turnover for each country is mentioned in this attachment, and also the VAT rate, so it's exactly known which amount the VET should be passed through to the separate member states. Yes, and here you see the mechanism, how it works. Doing so, the VET is going to the member states where the products are consumed, where the private persons are living. So that's exactly how it should work. And then the last step, number six, that's the possibility to compare the import data from customs with the VAT declaration data from the tax administration. So both institutes, customs as well as tax administration, are able to make this comparison. And then there are mismatches. So for example, there is more data on an import declarations than the VET data on the tax administration declaration. These mismatches will be sorted out. So the tax administration, at least in the Netherlands, starts an investigation and will ask the IOS registration holder for an explanation of these mismatches. Yeah, so here you see it's quite a new phenomenon within customs. Yes, within tax administration, this system, separate from customs declarations, is more or less already known because they have now the MOS, the mini one-stop shop. This is an extension. Okay, so remember, and it's very important, in the IOS, it's a single choice. You have to register, and there is a payment of the VET at the moment of ordering the goods. Then we go to the special arrangement. So this is another chapter, as I already said, Article 369 of this VET directive. Chapter 7 are some articles dedicated for this special arrangement. And here you see already the difference with the IOS. We see here less steps. So we don't see a registration and a special arrangement because there's no need to. We start here with ordering the goods. And here you see no payment of the VET. And so that's already a difference with the IOS. And not paying the VET at the moment of ordering the goods is more or less the same as what happens nowadays. These goods come to Europe, to the EU, there will be an import declaration, and there will be, if there is a possibility for the deferred payment of the VET. Because you didn't pay the VET at the moment of ordering the goods, you will have to pay the import VET, and you don't, it's not mandatory to pay this VET for each parcel over and over again, but you can compile all this VET together in a monthly payment. Again, customs will perform some checks. Remember the 150 euro, excise goods, etc. So very important. And step four, you see this monthly payment of the VET. Okay, so also for this special arrangement, that's also stated in this chapter 7 of this directive, that you are allowed to lodge this. No, it's mandatory to lodge the import declaration in the member state of destination. So that's again a very big difference with in comparison with the IOS. Yes, so special arrangement, when an airplane for, let's say, goods for 10 different countries and it starts at Schiphol Airport, then you, when you use the special arrangement, you can only lodge import declarations for the Dutch part of these goods. So when the goods are also for Belgium, for France, or for Italy, you name it, for all these countries, you can't lodge an import declaration regarding special arrangement in the Netherlands. You have to go with these goods to the member states of destinations. So via NCTS, and then after that, an import declaration in the country of destination. And here you see again that this VAT mechanism is working because also here is realized that the VAT is paid in the country of destination. Yes? So special arrangement, rather different than the IAS. And for some people, it's more or less, they think, well, it looks a lot like we do nowadays. And that's true. Then we go to the specific data set. Number three of the new elements that I mentioned in the beginning of this part. The super reduced data set, here you can see the article 143A from this EU regulation. And here you see the conditions. It is only applied for or related to consignments where the benefits from the duty, import duty relief, or Article 23 or 25 are applied for. Yes, Article 23, B2B, B2C. Article 25, C2C. Yes, so that's a very important criteria. Then you see the goods must not be subject to prohibitions and restrictions. So no, let's say roughly, no additional documents, no certificates, no licenses, permits, etc. Yes? It's not allowed to lodge a declaration for them. You can lodge a normal declaration, but it's not allowed to use the super reduced data set. And when you want to look into the details of this super reduced data set, I can refer you to Annex B and then column H7 of this EU legislation. So, and that's more or less already what you hear when customs together and business are talking, they only say H7. So a normal declaration is H1, the super reduced data set is H7. Yes, so you can find exactly which data elements are part of it. Okay. Here some more about this super reduced data set. It's possible for the IOS, it's possible for the special arrangement, but as I already stated, these are not mandatory, so you can also say, no, I want to lodge a normal declaration using the super reduced data set. So that's also possible. So to be clear, then it's not a normal declaration with the H1 data set, but a normal declaration with the H7 declarant. And in the Netherlands, it means using the super reduced data set, you must lodge the declaration into DECO. That means Douane e-commerce. That's a new system for the declaration, import declarations for goods, where you can use the super reduced data set. Yes. So when you use super reduced data set, you must go to DECO. You can't go to any other system from customs in the Netherlands. So not to AGS, not to Venue, not to import and the GPA, so the periodic declaration. No, only DECO. Okay. So now I'm at the end of this first part. So we have a few minutes left for some questions in relation to the elements of this first part. So, Albert, I don't know whether we have some questions already received.
We have. So thank you very much, Han, for that extensive explanation. We have questions. The first one of those is from Bert, who says, what is customs going to do about the growing number of drop shipment web shops that are importing outside the platforms iOS and Venue and are avoiding import duties and VAT? I think this is somebody who is experiencing that these guys are actually undercutting his business model.
Yeah, I think this is a good question, but I think we can do it at the end because it's more or less in the general scope of e-commerce, so not only related to the super reduced data set,
right,
et cetera.
So we'll keep that one.
Yes, we will come back.
And there is another question that was actually asked, I think, if I look at the time, just before you started talking about the special arrangement. Mm-hmm. From Dallas. I'm not sure if that's a person or a place. And it says, how will this new legislation affect goods coming from a bonded warehouse in the Netherlands? And will goods subject to the new rules have to be filed on this super reduced data set?
Yes. One of the criteria for this, for the use of the super reduced data set is that there must be the conditions of Article 23 and 25 must be fulfilled. And one of the conditions in Article 23 is a direct shipment to the private person. And goods in a bonded warehouse, they are not equal to a direct shipment. So you can't use the super reduced data set when the previous customs procedure is bonded.
Right. And because we got rid of the first question so quickly, there's another question here that says from how will customs know if the correct IOS number has been given in the declaration?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's like I said, customs is checking for each and every single declaration the validity of the IOS number. And the validity of the IOS number means that we are looking into the database from Brussels whether this IOS VAT number exists. Is it in this database, yes or no? And we only get one signal back from this database. It's yes or no, valid. So when this number exists, then we say okay. When this number doesn't exist, we refuse this declaration because we will do this check before the declaration is accepted by us. So it's a business rule. I always say it's a check at the front door. It's the first thing we do. Validity means that we are not able to say whether the right person, the right company is using his number. Mm. Yes, so there can be misuse of IOS VAT numbers.
Yeah.
But if this number exists, so another company misuses the number of another company, then we receive this signal back, yes, this number is valid.
Yeah.
So we are not able, at least not in this automated check with the database from Brussels, to check if the right company is using his own number.
But that could be a check later on. Then.
That could be a check later on, yes. And talking about one of these elements, these typical steps in the IOS, is this comparison at the end of the import data from customs and the tax administration data from this monthly VAT declaration.
Yeah.
So when numbers are misused, we will see a mismatch between these two data. And then, what I said before, this tax administration will ask this IOS number holder what happened.
Yeah, so yes. this is definitely a point that companies have to think about how
yes.
their process works and if this might lead to yes. a mismatch between IOS numbers and...
I know that this is a big point of concerns for business,
yeah.
that they are not sure that they can avoid misuse. So
yeah.
what will happen if this misuse will be there? So this is discussed a few times in Brussels, also from business who went to Brussels and asked, how are we going to do that? In the Netherlands, we are thinking about starting a group, customs, tax administration, also business, to talk about these new phenomenons, IOS, special arrangement, new declaration systems, etc. Customs and tax authorities working together in this new system.
Yeah.
And we will invite business also to share experiences, to share thoughts, to think together in solutions.
Right. Yeah.
But future will learn because we don't have these solutions already.
No. No, but I think that can be the typical Dutch way of dealing with this, right? That we,
yes.
okay, we hold each other's hands a little bit. And
yeah, let's talk about it. Let's think together and try to find solutions.
This block, before we go to the next presentation, we have one poll for you to look at, which is your opinion about the legislation. This reflects the presentation that Han has just provided to us. So let me open the poll and see how you think about this. What is your opinion? What do you think are the challenges in the new legislation? Is it too complex? Too many choices? Different implementations and explanations in different member states, or perhaps something we haven't thought about yet. So let's see this running. Han, what do you feel is the challenge in this new legislation?
I think it's more or less a mix, because I think there are several possibilities. So that it's not mandatory to use one system to make a choice.
No.
So you can say IOS yes or no, special arrangement yes or no. So, and that makes it difficult because I always use the example of we have three different parcels. They look exactly from the outside the same, but they can be in three different regimes. The first one can be in the IOS, the second one in the special arrangement,
yeah.
the third one in the normal procedure. how must we deal with that? So everything is to handle, but it makes it difficult. I also hear this from business. They say it could be easier when there was one mandatory system, because then it was clear for everyone. Yes. And it also, I think, makes it complex, talking about these mismatches, this previous discussion. It's something we are not used to. So, and it's not said that what we are not used to is no good, that's not the discussion, but everyone thinks that there will be mismatches and we have to solve them. So we have to get experience, a common feeling about consequences.
Yeah.
So that's also, I think, something we will have to face.
And I think the poll shows that there are, well, that most of you, I think, are worried about different implementations in different member states, and that's 34%.
Yep.
But also a good size of the audience was actually concerned about the complexity and the different choices. And we were just talking here, but you didn't hear because we were on pause.
Okay.
We were talking about the complexity.
Yes.
We're trying to create legislation that fits with the reality of industry, which has many different faces and many different ways,
yes,
of doing business. But that also at the same time brings with it quite some complexity, right? Quite
for
some
sure.
choices.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, and the different implementation in member states, yeah, that's always a point of concern. That's not typically related to e-commerce. You see it every time over and over again when there is new legislation. Every member state has to deal with it and makes its preparations. So, yes.
Yeah.
That's a point
right.
of concern.
Right. That brings us to the end of this first block. I apologize for the hiccup that we just had. It was a server connection problem. But I think we're all back now and ready to go on with the second presentation by Frank Heijman. So, Frank, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you, Albert. If you look at the new regulations, let's say the amendments of the Union Customs Code Delegated Act and Implementing Act, in both of those acts, it is actually only one or two provisions that are added to it, new annexes to the Implementing Act. And furthermore, indeed, like Han already said, two small chapters in the VAT directive. But the rules that were now made, they actually need an explanation of over 60 pages in the guidance of VAT, an explanation of over 75 pages in the guidance for low-value consignments for customs, and that already shows a lot about the complexity. And one of the disadvantages that we face, as we understand, although we understand all the changes and we understand that we want to have a better division of VAT collection in the EU and that the VAT ends up in the member state of actual consumption, the way that is chosen now creates a customs procedures on a transactional basis. And customs procedure on a transactional basis, and that considering B2C shipments, so e-commerce shipments, looking at what Albert just started with when he talked about the enormous growth that we are facing in e-commerce, and the COVID-19 added actually an enormous speed in this growth, then we see that we had to take some decisions at Dutch Customs simply to cope with all the volumes that we have to deal with in the near future. On the one hand, we have this increase. We see Brexit. We see that there is a lot of e-commerce shipments are being shipped to the EU from the UK. So from the 1st of January, also those are fully subject to customs procedures. The new legislation on the abolishment of the de minimis demands regular declarations for shipments below €22. We have around March next year, we have a new import control system release one, and it's ICS2, which is demanding new security declarations for postal consignments and international couriers. And then on top of that, let's say the changes on the 1st of July next year, referring to the chapter 6 and 7 and the super reduced data set, and actually the fact that everything has to be lodged to customs electronically. We have estimates that where in 2007, as customs in the vested industry, we dealt with maybe 20, 25 million declarations. In 2018, we were looking at maybe 40, 50 million declarations. And our expectation is that towards 2021, towards next year, that we will have to deal with several hundreds of millions of declarations. And this needs a complete different approach. When you have to look around, when this information is being lodged to us on a transactional basis, and we have to start calculating VAT on a single parcel for maybe even 5 or 10 euro cents of VAT, then the regular approach of customs in dealing with declarations and enforcement, where physical control is the traditional way of approach, that doesn't work anymore. That simply, it doesn't work when we talk about so many declarations. So we have taken a few decisions, but those few decisions are very, very much depending, actually, on decisions of the industry. As Han already explained, IOSS is optional. The special arrangement is optional. The super reduced data set, the use of it, is, in theory, optional. And then we look at a very small article or a change in Article 221 of Regulation 215-2447, which is the implementing regulation under the Delegated Act under the Union Customs Code, entering into force from next year. And it says, when a company, and Han already referred to it actually, when a company imports goods with an intrinsic value below 150 euro, when it's a private-to-private person shipment below 45 euro, and a relief of import duty is requested for those goods, then the customs office where the import declaration may be lodged will be the customs office in the member state of consumption, of final destination. That creates an enormous impact on international logistics. Where we have now a few hubs in the EU, like for example in Belgium, you have Liège, you have Leipzig in Germany, Cologne in Germany, we have of course Charles de Gaulle, France, Paris, we have Amsterdam Airport. These are a few major hubs where a lot of e-commerce goods are being brought into the European Union. And what the current industry does is then they completely declare the goods for free EU circulation, very often at that hub. And that's not possible anymore when you when you import those consignments that I just mentioned and you ask for a relief of import duty. Then the goods have to be put on transit, and when the goods are destined for different member states, they have to be forwarded to the country of destination, and there an import declaration has to be lodged. This will have an enormous impact on the complete flow of logistics as it's running now, where goods from an Amsterdam airport hub are brought immediately to the region's final destination in the EU. Then you will have to have those shipments being moved first to a central place in Germany, a central place in Belgium, a central place in, for example, France. There is one exception, and this is the use of the IOSS. Because the aim of this procedure or this rule is that the VAT actually is added to the member state of final consumption. And the IOSS is a different system. When companies choose for the IOSS, then you can fully declare the goods in the Netherlands, and the platform has a deferred payment system under the IOSS with the monthly declaration, and then the goods can be brought to the member states. And via the monthly declaration, as Han already explained, the VAT will end up in the right member state. And there is another exception when it's a B2B shipment, where in the Netherlands there is the deferred payment of Article 23 on the national VAT law is being applied for, because then the goods are actually destined always for a VAT liable person in the Netherlands, who then provides for when it's a representative intra-community supply to the member state of destination. So the vested industry with its B2V low-value consignments is hardly affected when they use the deferred payment in the Netherlands. But what is now the difficulty, that's the estimate of what is the industry is now doing, will have an enormous impact on the impact on the flow of goods in the Netherlands. Will businesses choose for the IOSS, then we will have to deal maybe with hundreds of millions of declarations. And at the same time, when they do not choose for the IOSS, then those shipments will only be brought into the country in the Netherlands and be moved to other countries by NCTS, so by transit documents. And it's for us very difficult to really adapt to this situation up front when you don't know what actually the industry is doing. If you look at the content of the decisions that we made, simply to prepare on the volume, on the UK situation, and the unpredictability of what trade actually is doing, we say that from the 1st of January, our first step that we would prefer is the use of Venue. Venue is a simplified declaration system which is used in the Netherlands since 7-8 years in its current system. It was a blueprint simplified procedure that we already used in the previous decennium with the international couriers. And it's turned into an electronic declaration system. And it requires a license, a specific license, because it's a simplified customs declaration. And it provides the possibility to do a larger simplified declaration by couriers and postal services. And it can also be lodged as a pre-lodgement, so a kind of an advanced declaration. In 2017, we extended the options for different parties that can use this simplified procedure to other parties in the supply chain, but they have a bit of a limited use of the Venue system. But what is important in Venue, it is a simplified declaration, and the law says that a supplementary declaration needs to be lodged. And it does not need to be lodged in case the simplified declaration already contains all the parameters that are needed to bring the goods into free circulation. And the way it works is that all the goods that are now subject to relief of VAT under the 22 euro limit, so they don't have to pay VAT, that we say the Venue declaration already provides for enough information, so you do not need to lodge a supplementary declaration. But when there is a VAT payment at stake, then a supplementary declaration needs to be lodged at the moment in our national regular declaration system, which is called AGS, or our monthly declaration system, the entry in the declarant's records, which is in the Netherlands called GPA. That's the current situation. But now we are facing, from the 1st of January, of course, UK shipments. And Han already explained the e-commerce provisions, they enter into force on the 1st of July. And from the 1st of July, we will have this new DECO system, which I will come to in a minute. But it would mean that in the meanwhile, companies importing goods from the UK between the 1st of January and the 1st of July, they would need to certainly lodge regular declarations, even for e-commerce shipments, in the AGS system. And as you said, this is something that we simply do not want. The AGS system, the regular declaration system in the Netherlands, is developed for B2B shipments. It's developed for the calculation of import duties. It's developed for the link to the TARIC databases, for harmonized system codes, and it analyzes all the prohibitions and restrictions that apply. It analyzes all the certificates. And when you look at B2C shipments, e-commerce shipments, they're actually not subject to the majority of those rules. So AGS is actually taking a too long processing time for what is required in that industry. And therefore, we created the possibility from the 1st of January that UK goods can also be processed in the venue simplified procedural system, and that we created the possibility for specifically those goods to pay VAT in venue. What is the advantage? You have a simplified declaration for UK goods. The value under 150 euro, only VAT needs to be paid. But because VAT can be paid via the venue system, no supplementary declaration is required in the regular declaration system, AGS, anymore. We introduced this to serve the industry. We introduced this to make it simpler, easier for the industry. And we also said that specifically for businesses that will apply for this situation in venue, that they do not need to make the investment for only half a year, but we extended the lifetime of the venue system until the end of 2022. So the investment is actually worthwhile for the business to make. However, if a company, even for UK goods, decides on the 1st of July that they want to apply for the IOSS system, or they apply for the special arrangement for the VAT, then they still have to move from venue to the DECO system, because the venue does not provide for IOSS and special arrangement. However, what we hope to create for the industry is to have a simplified way of declaring e-commerce goods from the UK from the 1st of January on, and that VAT is paid in the simplified declaration and no additional declaration requirements come up for the industry. And again, the choice is up to the industry whether the IOS is being chosen. For the simplified procedure as such, venue is normally end of life, as I said, on the 30th of June next year, when you demand for duty relief. But for UK goods, the extension is until the end of 22. When companies still want venue to use that are not using the system at the moment, it requires a license, and for the license, you need to submit an application. The application forms can be found on the customs website, douane.nl. There is also a brochure on the website. Actually, it's now in Dutch, and in a couple of days, we hope to have it published in English as well. And the brochure exactly prescribes what are the requirements for the simplified declaration, how do you have to provide the declaration to customs in an electronic way. So it also prescribes the technical procedures, and it prescribes the control procedures. And it's had the absolute preference that the business chooses for venue, because the AGS system cannot guarantee the speed of handling that is required for the industry in e-commerce. Then we have the custom system DECO, which is Douane e-commerce. And this is the simplified declaration system for e-commerce, which the Netherlands has built or is building still, when businesses start using the data set of column 7, Annex B, so the super reduced data set. A declaration with the super reduced data set cannot be lodged in the regular import system AGS in the Netherlands. It needs to be lodged if you want to use it, in the DECO system. And the DECO system, with the use of the super reduced data set, is possible for when you, or needed if you want to use the IOSS, the special arrangement, or the normal declaration procedure in the SDR. What is important is that for shipments that are below 150 euro and relief of import duty is requested, that it's an obligation in the Netherlands to use that system again, except B2B shipments with a VAT deferred payment in the Netherlands. Furthermore, you have to use that system, because we want to keep the AGS system for the real B2B processing with all the other measures and prohibitions and restriction control systems that are behind it. And the IOSS also is only offered in this DECO system, and it's not offered in the AGS system. So DECO is an obligation from the 1st of July. The actually accept the situation that I started with, which is UK goods, because they can still be lodged, even with the relief of import duty, in the venue system because of the special transitional measures that we created for the UK. Very important for the system DECO is that it is required to use the super reduced data set. It is only for the payment of VAT. So it's what already was said, as soon as the goods are getting within, coming to an intrinsic value above 150 euro, DECO is not possible. No excise goods, etc. There is no additional declaration required in the regular import system, and it is not allowed for any goods with prohibitions or restrictions. So, that, for example, if there is a certificate required, if you want to import meat from Scotland in the future, or meat from everywhere, anywhere in the world, then it's a phytosanitary or veterinarian certificate required, then it is not allowed to use DECO. Those have to be lodged in the regular system. So it's a really simplified system merely for the processing of VAT and the collection of VAT declarations. If you want to use it from the 1st of January, then the companies need to have electronic messaging registration, which is simply lodging a form to customs. There are message implementation guidelines for the for setting up the electronic communication to customs. If a company wants to lodge declarations via the DECO system on behalf of someone else, then you need to have an empowerment to act as a customs representative. Sometimes it may be the end consumer who lets himself represented by a customs agent who will lodge the declaration in DECO. Sometimes it will be the shipper or the seller who is required to provide the empowerment. But if you want to act as a customs representative, you have to at least have empowerment for that. And every company that lodges declarations in DECO needs to have an authorization, so a license for comprehensive guarantee. Because it is automatically in the Netherlands a system where there is a deferred payment granted under a guarantee for the VAT that is calculated. And it's a monthly payment system of the VAT, which actually, for those who work already with AGS system, it's comparable to what we have in AGS. So a quick look back to the points I made. Preferably, if you import goods from the UK, use the venue system from the 1st of January and use it with the payment of VAT. You make a single choice at the start of the license for use, for payment of VAT for UK goods, and then you get a daily invoice from out of venue for the VAT that is due to be paid on all the declarations on a certain day. Other declarations for e-commerce also can be lodged in venue, but there, when VAT is liable, then a supplementary declaration is required in AGS. On the 1st of July 2021, everything from venue, AGS, and from the Dutch entry in the declarant's record system, subject to relief of import duties below 150 euro, moves to the DECO system. Again, except the UK, because there we have this extended period till the end of 22. And then from the 1st of January 23, we hope that we only will have two declaration systems. The one is Douane e-commerce DECO for the low value consignments, and the other one is the successor of AGS, which is DMS, Declaration Management System. Why is that being changed, AGS into DMS? Because also on the 1st of January 2023, a complete new Annex B will be implemented by the EU with complete new data sets and data structures, and that requires a full makeover of our regular declaration system And therefore, it's called then DMS. And what we hope with these measures is that we can deal with the increasing amounts, the enormous volumes that we have to deal with in the next few years, which is a direct consequence from, on the one side, the consumer behavior of COVID-19, everything is ordered at home, but another direct consequence of the transactional measures that have been implemented by the EU, which bring great challenges for the industry as well as for customs. So far, my contribution to the systems, the Eco Venue, AGS, and in particular where I started with Article 221, paragraph 4, and feel free to ask any questions.
Thank you, Frank. So let's see if we have some questions from our audience, particularly on the part that Frank talked about. There is one question in my screen here that says, the iOS not being mandatory, why would a platform sign up for it? From Eddie.
Yeah, it's a very good question. Why would a platform sign up for the iOSS? It is up to the platform to decide. And we've been talking to the industry, and we see that the industry is still doubting about what are the benefits. It's just a bit double. If you look at, there are companies that say, now, when I already calculate the VAT at the moment of sale, then I don't have to have any payment interventions anymore at the place and moment of delivery to the consumer, because you can calculate transaction cost, transport cost, VAT, everything right from the start. And that can save money in logistics and save money in last mile delivery. Another consideration of the industry is, but I have to lodge a declaration for security purposes already. I have to lodge a declaration for customs purposes anyway. And the only thing that I get to it is another declaration on a monthly basis that I have to lodge for the VAT IOSS. So it's another declaration on top of the range of transactional declarations that I already have to do. I lodge an extra declaration, and then that additional declaration also creates a liability for a platform for VAT. It relates to all kind of questions that tax and customs administrations may ask to a platform once they start doing this monthly match of declarations. And I think the consideration of the choice of either one of them is really an individual business situation, notwithstanding actually that a platform is not a platform, because we also saw that many platforms have different business model behind it. There are platforms that do indeed sell via their platform, but it are other people's, other parties' goods. And yes, you can pay via the platform, but it's not the platform that actually knows what money is being paid, but that is an additional banking system which is added to the platform, which is owned by a different company. So the question is, even if all the platforms, if they would want to choose for IOSS, if they actually would be able to meet the requirements of it. So it's depending on the industry.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting to see if that will work out. It occurred to me also that with DECO, there are quite some conditions, right? Conditions on the you shouldn't have goods with prohibitions and restrictions. What if you choose DECO and it turns out that there some prohibitions or restrictions pop up for some of your goods as a result of some geopolitical policy making or whatever? Then is there some sort of transition mechanism in place that you can take those goods out of DECO and move to AGS, DMS? How does that work? And how quickly do you need to figure this out?
Yeah, it's a very good point, and it's actually a very difficult one. As Han already said, some rules and regulations, restrictions, we all can stop at the front door. If the value is intrinsic value is a certain tick box in the declaration, and if it's over 150, then we refuse it at the front door. If it's an IOSS and the IOSS number doesn't exist, we already refuse it at the front door. Well, what happens if you indeed lodge a declaration and then customs will check it? and they, for example, see that it's a product which is prohibited. Yeah, you import via e-commerce, deco, a hand grenade, whatever, and then it's prohibited. Then you could say two ways. You could either say, but you were actually not allowed to lodge this declaration, so you cancel the declaration, or you actually follow up the mechanism of the declaration and you start confiscating the goods and give a fine for a false declaration. Yeah. That's either choices. The more difficult one occurs when actually it turns out that the goods, after lodging the declaration, and then it that's already the intrinsic value is below 140 or 150, and customs will control it, and then it turns out that it will be 180. Do you then amend the declaration? Now, the way that we chose it up to now in the Netherlands is that we say, you are not allowed to lodge that declaration up front because it's more than 150 euros. So we cancel the declaration and you have to lodge a new one in AGS. So it's not an action that customs will take due to the correction of the declaration, but we put it back to the industry because otherwise, considering all those millions, customs is simply not able to handle all these difficulties in the declaration process, because it all holds up the release of the goods.
Right, and e-commerce needs to go fast.
And e-commerce needs to go fast, and it just means that the majority of the problems we actually want to put back on the table of the declarant, and we don't want to have it on our table. So we're not out, we're not aiming at an enormous increase and enormous volume of corrections of declaration. We're aiming actually at receiving a right declaration. And that's the responsibility of the industry. It's not the responsibility of customs.
But this is a very interesting point, but I just pause here a little bit to let it sink in, because we don't have time. We need to go to another poll. So we asked you this question already. How do you, what do you think of the legislation? We thought of, after you've heard these two presentations about the regulation and about the way Dutch customs tries to tackle them, and also balance, I guess, to some extent, the responsibilities of customs and industry, we would like to pose this question to you again. So let's have a look and see if we have enlightened anybody. Takes a few seconds for all of you to see. Remember that we had 44% in the don't know category last time we asked this question about an hour ago. And I think I'm looking sternly at you to see if you have taught anybody anything. It looks like it, because now our percentage of the don't know category is still not above 24. Although we have also some people who are now firmly convinced, more than previous time, that the legislation is actually inadequate. So we did sway the needle a little bit, but actually in both directions, it seems. Although, to be fair, we have now, instead of 27% last time, we have 42%. It's creeping up a little bit because people are still voting.
Now maybe it's good to add in this sense that the question adequate, inadequate, it's also the complexity of the choice. There are so many different choices in this system, whether you use IS, use super reduced data sets, choose for a normal declaration, choose for a special arrangement. And that is very difficult for the industry. The one is very often looking at the other. What are you doing? What's my neighbor doing? And then what choice shall I make? And at the end, was the choice of the neighbor maybe a better one than mine? Why didn't I choose the other option? Yeah. So, and we see in different industries, it's the experience a bit, that the industry is not benefited always by having a lot of options in legislation. They very often said, then if it's the way it is, then give us it and say how we have to do it, and that's the way we do it. Yeah. So you will not create, let's say, choices, options in legislation as competitive instruments.
Yeah, so let's have a look at the final outcome. Adequate 41%, inadequate 35%, don't know 24. So I think about half of the group that said don't know last time knows something at least and has made is competent enough at least to figure out if they think it's adequate or inadequate. So, I think that already shows us that this webinar is well directed. There is one final thing that we still have to do, and that is to have a discussion in a bit more detail about how you can actually declare goods. And there's a whole bunch of scenarios. I think that was already clear from the presentation that Frank gave us. So I would again like to give the floor to Han to talk us through some of the possible scenarios for declaring goods.
Okay. Thank you, Robert. And thank you, Frank. Yes, so what I want to do now is look together with you to some schemes we made. And these schemes are a graphic representation of what we said previous in this session. So let's cut it down a little bit. We have two blocks. First, we have the UK goods. And after that, we will look to the other non-EU goods. So with the exemption of UK. So and we have three time frames. The first one is from the 1st of January next year until the 13th of June. So the first half year. The second block will be from the 1st of July, because then we have this new EU legislation. And it will go on until the 31 December 2022, because Frank already stated, the 1st of January 2023, we will have this DMS, or our new system, and all these new annexes in, all these new columns and declaration sets in Annex B. So let's start with the UK goods. And the common question each time is, the first question you must answer, is there a duty relief applied according to Article 23 or 25 from this duty relief regulation? Because that's always in the middle of this discussion. I mean, there are only two answers possible, yes or no. So when you apply for this duty relief, you go to the left side of this scheme. And then the question is, are there restricted goods involved, yes or no? So are there additional documents, certificates, licenses, etc.? When it's no, you can make a choice in between the systems, venue, AGS, and GPA. And so a lot of goods, most common goods, below 150 euro, the exemption for the duty is applied. We go to the left side, no restricted goods. So a lot of them are going left down under. When you don't apply for this duty relief, Article 23 or 25, you go to the right side of the scheme. Or when there are restricted goods, also to the right side. And going to the right side means that there are two more questions you have to answer. First one is, do I have a venue license before 1st of January 2017? Yes or no? Frank already stated the reason why. So the users before the 1st of January 2017, the possibilities to use this license is broader than the companies who have the license after the 1st of January 2017. So that's a critical question. And another one will be, when I don't apply for this duty relief of Article 23 or 25, do I want to apply for another exemption, yes or no? And answering this question with no, then you have to answer the question, do I have a venue license, yes or no? And each time you see the difference to these questions will lead you to the use of either AGS or the GPA, or the use of venue, AGS or the GPA. Yeah, so it's very good to find your way into this system and into this flowchart. So let's try with a little example. You order an umbrella from outside the UK, from the UK, and this umbrella is via internet, etc., 20 euro, and it's coming to here. because it's 20 euro, until the 1st of July next year, there is still this exemption of the VAT for goods below 22 euro. So you can apply for this exemption. So you go to the left side, and then the only question you have to answer is this umbrella a restricted good? So let's say no, it's a normal product, nothing special, just 20 euro, and then you can make the choice, venue, AGS, GPA. And as Frank already stated, goods from the UK, we are in favor with the choice for venue. Yes? Because we prepared venue especially for these goods. Another example can be, I thought Frank mentioned this.
Meat.
This meat, yes, meat from Scotland. Also ordered via the internet, let's say, also 20 euro.
Leg of lamb.
But you need certificates for this meat, so this is a restricted good. So you go to the right side of the scheme. And then you must look for the answer. Do I have a license venue before the 1st of January 2017, yes or no, or do I have a license at all? Yes. So again, you see some possibilities to choose for venue when you go to the right side. Yes, so I think the most easiest way for you is just to look into these schemes, take a product, take an example, and try to find out where you end. Yes, so this is UK goods from the first half year. Then we go to 1st of July for 1.5 years. You see on the left side, that's the only difference with the previous slide, on the left side you see only left venue and deco. You don't see AGS, you don't see the GPA, because Frank already told you everything has to go to deco, except for the UK goods, they can stay in venue. And then it becomes really easy, but we have to wait a little time. From the 1st of January 2023, you see there is only a possibility to make a choice between DECO and DMS. Yes, remember also the attention, please, for what's on the bottom of this slide. When you want to apply for the IOS or the special arrangement, also for UK goods, you must go to DECO. You can't use these systems in venue. Yes? So that's UK. Then we go to, this is a summary of all the three slides together. Looking to the time, I think we can skip this one and we go to the next one. And that's again the first half year next year, but then from the goods outside the EU, not UK. And here you see on the left side, you see this distinction between goods below 22 euro and goods between 22 euro and 150 euro. And here you see also the possibility for the postal operator in the Netherlands to use the declaration by any act for goods below 22 euro. Yes. On the right side, this scheme is exactly the same as it was for UK. Yes? Then we continue with non-EU goods without UK from 1st of July. And here you see on the left side, you see the change. You are allowed only to use DECO. So no venue anymore because it's not UK. No AGS, no GPA. Yes, so from the 1st of July next year, we see a big move from all these current systems going towards DECO. And then, again, the most easiest one, from the 1st of January 2023, we have only this DECO system and this DMS system. Yes? So, just here you see again a summary of these previous three slides, so you can find your way, try to look at. You also see this Article 23 of the VAT Netherlands, the special deferred payment method for the VAT and B2B shipments, so it's also included. Yes. So don't try to understand this immediately. Take the time, perhaps use the holidays, the upcoming holidays, to get some feelings with all these schemes. So we thought it was that help can help you to make your choice and find your way into all of these systems. Okay. So that's my contribution regarding the schemes.
Yeah, let me switch this back.
Sorry, then it's up to
you. Yes, thank you very much. So the schemes, I think, highlight a little bit the complication that we have already pinpointed a few times in this webinar before. But hopefully there is light at the end of the tunnel in 2023. So this means that we are done with the presentations. We still have some stuff to do, which is to answer some of your questions. And we had a question that was already asked very much at the beginning of the webinar that I would like to pick up now because it was a more generic question. And I will come back to that one, which is from Bert, who says, what is customs going to do about the drop shipment web shops that are importing outside the platforms iOS and Venue and are avoiding duties and import duties and taxes? So what... Let's have a look at that question.
Okay, yes, we can have. Yes, these drop shipments passing by the platforms, etc. So this is, and that's typically e-commerce. We see regularly basis, we see new business models. And this is also an example of such a new business model. And what we are faced to is to try to make the supervision fit towards these new business models. So we must react. So because that's one thing we learned, it's not just customs in the Netherlands, it's customs EU, it's even customs worldwide. We see there's this e-commerce business, which is very dynamic, is more in a hurry than we are normally able to change all our mechanisms, all our systems, etc. So we need innovation. We need advanced techniques. So not only physical checks by opening a parcel, etc., but also to try to do checks in advance or make use of algorithms for automatic scans, but also regarding data. So we need these new techniques to be able to react on all these new business models that will occur. Because drop shipments, it's new, but for sure it will not be the last new one. There will be new ones next year. So we try to be as flexible as possible because we are not able to perform only this physical check because the growth of the number of parcels is so huge. We can double our number of employees and then still we are not able to check all these physical ones. So we have to think about an innovative way of supervision.
Yeah, but that's maybe a bridge to Frank, trade relations. And so this seminar is part of the effort, I think, to at least explain to a lot of the companies who want to do this want to do a good job, what the procedures are and how this is going to evolve over the next few years. But Frank, could you say a few things about how Dutch Customs is trying to work together with trade to really get through this period and this complex period of the different systems and the different changes in regulation? How do you see that? Is it just like we have been doing this already with the regular meetings and the regular discussions, or is there something in addition to that that we need to really get through this?
Now, what I already said in the beginning is the National Committee on Trade Facilitation is a certain group of trade associations that covers the whole international supply chain. But we already saw here are new players. Here are declaration service providers. They are something different than the traditional customs broker. We have integrators. They cover a certain part of the supply chain on behalf of platforms. We have suddenly platforms, so internet providers, which are not familiar to movement of cross-border movement of goods. And what we try to do is to involve these industries in our dialogue as well. So we've asked our National Committee on Trade Facilitation, do you support when we set up an additional group? And in this additional group, we want to involve those parties as well. And not everybody can join the table, but because we want to have a few representatives. And we are open on the discussion of as much as possible the problems that we are all facing. That's the one side. But on the other hand, Customs is an enforcement agency. We're not only there for trade facilitation and a declaration factory, we have to enforce. You already mentioned the non-compliance of the import of goods in one of your first slides. We also see non-compliance in this business. We are facing a certain industry, certain sectors, where there is the non-compliance level is really dozens of percentages compared to the whole movement of goods that they have. And it's comparing to the value, the quality of the declaration, the quality of the products, whatever is being imported, there is a high level of non-compliance. And we want to cover that, and we need to cover that. So what Customs is doing is we are trying to split the flows a little bit. We already have in the Netherlands a vision, a long-term vision, enforcement vision, where we say the authorized, the trusted traders, authorized economic operators, they are being controlled on the level to check their level of compliance, not the traditional risk assessment. We are working on pipelines, trade, international trade lanes. We call that yellow flows, where we want to have reuse information actually from the source. And next, we have the blue flow, and what we see the blue flow is the other traders who not fit in the green flow, not the compliant, not the pipeline traders. But the blue flow, what we now see, even, that is almost all e-commerce, is what we can call blue flow, because they don't meet the actual high-level criteria of trusted traders or trusted trade lanes. So what we're now trying to do is even to create different segments in that blue flow. And these segments are depending on what are the clients of the parties that provide the declarations to us? For example, the couriers, the vested couriers, they have a lot of B2B shipments. That's a complete different industry than that unknown platforms to consumers. And we put those couriers in a different segment, and we use our traditional risk assessment to that. We also have all these new players that Hans just mentioned. Yeah, there we still have to do the interventions in a traditional way. And we want to set up smart technology as much as possible. We want to build algorithms in scanning devices. But one thing is for sure, the ones that we don't know, they have the less facilitation in international trade. And in the middle, there will be a segment of platforms where we see that the parties that lodge the declarations to customs, they only work on behalf of a few clients, a few platforms. And what we actually want to do is to have those parties to join up, have a better level of data sharing, better visibility on source information. And if you, as a declaration service provider, only have 2, 3, or 4 clients, then you can should be able to influence them. Yeah. And we want to have the dialogue on the level of the chain and the chain partners. So we want to split even our blue flow, couriers, risk-based. We have the what we call actor-driven approach, where we talk to the industry and say, influence your partners, and then the remaining part. And one thing is for sure, the remaining part, where either the level of non-compliance is high or the level of knowledge that we have or are able to get from the supply chain is very low, then the interventions in logistics in those flows will be much higher. If you want to have predictability in your international trade flows, then the best way to get it is to be as transparent as possible, because the higher the level of information that customs have, the less the risk that you get intervened in your logistical chain.
Right. I'm looking at my screen.
Perhaps
sorry,
I can add a little bit from an international perspective. Because I said I'm joining several project groups in Brussels, looking to the EU. It's not an isolated discussion. So the Commission said, let's talk about this new legislation and find solutions, etc., in a broader prospect. So not just customs, but also with business. So there are postal operators involved, couriers involved, even platforms involved. So it's a mix of all kinds of actors and participants, and try to find solutions together. So typical examples we can show them at the end of this session, or the guidance documents which were made under the umbrella of the Commission regarding VET, looking to these new measures, regarding customs, looking to these new measures. So these are really helpful documents.
Yeah.
Another international aspect, the World Customs Organization, also they have created a framework of standards, global, for implementing supervision on e-commerce for each country in the world. And this is also a cooperation between customs, academia, business, etc. So more and more you see this interaction between not only government, also business, also academia.
Okay, so that's very much, let's say, the discussion that we've had before. Eh? I think looking at my screen, I see that businesses are also concerned about more practical things. For instance, mm-hmm. the fraud with iOS numbers. This is a new scheme, right? A new mechanism, even though it already exists on the tax side. I think we, from what I see from the moderators, is that there are a lot of questions about what if my iOS number is out there, somebody is misusing it, where's the burden of proof, how do we organize responsibilities, how are we going to deal with this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's more or less a daily question already. So what's about big concerns about this integrity of the use of this IELTS numbers? And at this moment, we are at the stage that, like I said before, there will be a mismatch when this occurs, misuse. There will be a mismatch between the data from customs during import and the data tax authorities this monthly VAT declaration.
Yeah.
And the first thing the tax authorities will do is start with questioning the IOS number holder, because he is, from a point to start, the first one responsible for what's happening with his number. So also questions about misuse of this number will be laid back to this actor. When this actor can say, okay, I didn't lodge any import declaration at all of it, it was done not at all on my behalf. Yeah. Then the next one could be the one who lodged import declarations. So then we have to look to representation. Was it on an own name or on behalf? Was it direct representation? Was it indirect representation? So, and then we have already at least this non-EU seller. Yes, this platform or this company who is dealing itself. It's also one who could be asked to give solutions. But do we have one single answer, simple answer, to get a generic solution for all these? No, at this moment, we're not able. We will, like I said, we will create in the Netherlands a group, customs, tax authorities, business, to talk about mismatches, reasons why they occur, but also possible solutions to try to not to have them over and over again.
But one thing is absolutely sure, that the, let's say, the IOS liable person is the first one to be approached.
Yes.
Because there is a mismatch between his monthly VAT declaration and the information that is being shared via the national customs systems with the tax administration. All the imports of in all the EU countries under a certain IOS number, they will all be communicated via the European Commission and listed towards the countries where the IOS is registered, where the IOS declaration, the monthly declaration, needs to be lodged. So there the mismatch will occur, and the first person to actually approach will always be the IOS liable person.
Yeah.
And he is the first one to explain. Now, most probably he will say, I declared everything that was declared that I needed to declare that was imported on my behalf. Now, and then customs need to go back, or then this information needs to be go back from that certain tax administration in any member state to all the customs administrations in all the other member states where the imports actually took place. And there, the declarant needs to be approached.
Yeah.
So it will be quite a complex process where the first steps of the involvement of the IOS liable person is always very high.
But I think it also makes a lot of sense, right, for the IOS liable person to make sure that their codes are not easy to transfer. That there is some thinking to do there, I think, also on the hackability, I guess, of the database in Brussels. So there's a few other safeguards that could be discussed and could be put in place,
yeah.
Apart from, well, if a problem occurs, then this is what we're going to do.
Yes, it's written down in this guidance for the VET, for example.
Yeah.
There is a little paragraph about how to deal with your IS number and don't give it to anyone. And
right.
Be sure that the one you give, there is a contract in between these companies. So where is also stated what will be consequences when this number is misused, yeah. Etc.
But we have to be honest, we have considerable doubts about whether this really reflects the reality of the industry.
Yeah, but it's a business concern, right?
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's a very valid concern.
Yeah.
Let's see, the idea as it's laid down in the guidance document, where it said that the business has to take precautionary measures, the business has to take contractual measures, that the information on the IOD, that the number as such is not being shared wider than the range of parties that have a commercial relationship. That's nice to put it down on paper, but the question is really whether that really reflects the relationship in the international industry, where a number simply has and needs to be communicated between different parties, and how can you then, let's say, the owner of that number put on any burden on him that number is not being spread by other persons? It will be really, really difficult.
But maybe that's where we need some innovation, right?
Yes,
we are discussing a lot in the Netherlands about and not sharing data, but making data accessible in a system-to-system connection and that sort of thing, so that actually no living person can look at the numbers.
Yep.
They are also protected on the screen, so that you can actually not copy them or see them or whatever. Yeah. So there's a whole bunch of things that that companies can still
do, I think,
protect themselves.
Yeah.
There was also a question about, okay, what will happen when something goes wrong? So you related some steps that customs is then going to take. Is that going to be formalized? Is there a protocol, or is that just common sense? You say, well, we'll talk to them first, and then to them, and then to somebody else. Or is there going to be a sort of a predictable stepwise plan on how that is going to be approached?
No, I think it's
a flowchart.
It's from flowchart, but it's more from a logical point of view. Mm. So because the mismatch will occur at the VET the tax administration. So they will see there is a mismatch,
right.
And the one who is communicating with them is the IS holder.
Yeah,
that's not the one who should not be the one who has lodged the import declaration. So the most logical step is first one, who is liable for the correctness of this VET declaration, that's the holder of this IOS number. So that's the first one to talk to.
Right.
The second one is who lodged another declaration, customs.
Yeah.
So I think we don't have to make a very big protocol out of that. It's more a logical way of thinking.
So, and also, I think maybe it's also good to underline that part of this whole way of thinking and some of the decision making in customs, in Dutch customs at least, is about responsibilities of customs and responsibilities of trade, right?
So yes, for sure.
Part of this problem, or part of this, the solution is also here at the side of trade, right? So you expect companies very much to think about this issue and to also do things on their side to cover this.
Yes, it's. I think it needs a positive approach from both sides.
Yeah.
So but that's how we try to deal every day at Dutch customs. So we are not from it's written down this way. So end of discussion. That's the only way it is. So we are always trying to find solutions, etc., on a reasonable scale, for sure.
I would like to go back to my screen because there was one question popping up here that was in relation to the discussion on complexity and fragmentation of choices that I would maybe like to put on the table one more time. It's from Sophie from Amazon, who says that this driver of fragmentation and complexity is also to some extent embedded in the VAT law in Europe. It creates all these yes. variants yeah, and yeah, possibilities. Yes.
It's already there.
Could you reflect on that a little bit? Is that simply something that we have to deal with? Yes. It's not going away,
no,
or is it going to? Well, we've seen in the schemes that the declaration possibilities eventually will sort of yeah. tunnel into two options. So yeah, yeah. that
no,
might.
I think at least in the next coming years there will be no change. So there are a lot of different. Ways to declare and pay the VAT. So we have already the distance rules sales within the EU that's used nowadays or can be used nowadays. This will be there will be from the 1st of July this OS system. But OS again, it's not mandatory, so this distance sales rules still will be there. So it will be on and on and on, and every time there is a new possibility, and there is, at least not to my thoughts, there the current possibilities are skipped. No, there's always an addition of the one who are already existing. So I think this is the approach we see from the common legislation from Brussels. It's a multiple choice. For the VAT,
yeah.
and for the at least I don't know how Frank has experience about it, but in my experience, for the coming years it will be this.
If you look at what the changes are, look at on a customs level, you look at the Union Customs Code, and implementing and delegated acts, it is five times as thick as what we had in the Community Customs Code before. If you look at the VAT directive. It's still actually a transitional act. 1993 was a temporary rule. We're 17 years ahead, and next year we will be 18 years ahead, and it's still the transitional rule, and it became longer and longer and more complex and more complex. On the long term, this is absolutely not possible anymore. Let's be honest. If you look at what's happening, and I explained to you what's happening into customs declarations, we are not the only member state. And many member states, they suffer. They suddenly have to deal with hundreds of millions of customs declarations. The whole system in import is based on a transactional basis. What we here also see is that we had historically, let's say, rather good alignment, very good alignment between VAT at importation and customs procedures, that this alignment all is taken apart a little bit. That there are so many mismatches between VAT law and customs law nowadays, and this IOSS and all these schemes that are being introduced, they absolutely not contribute to improvement of alignment. It's actually the opposite. If you look at the guidance and the mega complexity that is being introduced about goods that cannot be delivered and the return and the VAT refunds that customs need to give, that on the long term this doesn't work, and this whole transactional system doesn't on the long term work, but because it's not only customs burden. If you look at international trade and you look at a courier who suddenly needs to lodge for a parcel of a value of 5 euros, where a VAT value is at stake of maybe 1 euro, he has to lodge a preload declaration for safety and security. He has to lodge to a shared European trader interface. The information is being shared to the member state of final destination. At the moment of arrival, there has to be lodged a declaration. Then he has to be lodged an import declaration. When he lands at import at a country which is not the final destination, then he either has to make an IOS, an NCTS declaration. When the goods arrive in an IOS, then there has to come a supplementary declaration. And this all for 5 euro value, 1 euro of VAT, five declarations in an international trade flow, which if you look at what the introduction of ICS1 cost, and actually you, Albert, were one of the people that investigated 10 years ago what the costs, or 7 years ago, what the costs for trade were for the implementation of ICS, and you calculated, as if I remember well, that one ENS record in the total supply chain created a cost of 15 euros per declaration line on an ENS, then you can imagine what five declarations subsequently will cost for to create, to cover 5 euros of value and 1 euro of VAT. This is, right, on the long term, it will never work.
But on this rather depressing note, I guess, we have to move towards the end of this webinar. But yeah, I agree with you. And this is not for free, what we're doing and the regulation that's being implemented. Sure. And this is costing us as society money. Yeah, that's clear, I think. But at the same time, I hope we have explained that we are trying to do this diligently. We are trying to move towards a system. I say we, I'm not really that much involved, but customs is trying to move towards a system that is more clear, is more succinct, with limited number of systems, but there is a period that we have to get through to, yes, to accomplish that. There is one more thing that we would like the audience to think about, and I will bring up the last poll before we say goodbye. And that is that we would very much like to know if you've appreciated this this webinar and if you would like to have another one. So because you're all going to think about this in due course, and you're all going to come up with more questions, more detailed questions, more specific problems, I would imagine. So there is a possibility to do this again. And that's the question we are posing to you. And I think very quickly, we are ending up with 99. This looks like North Korean voting outcomes. 99%. So basically, almost all of you see the need to do this again. So I think that's a clear clear judgment there. Yes. Let me stop.
We didn't do well enough.
Well, I think there are plenty of questions that remain to be answered. So I think the audience can now see the outcome of this question. I already mentioned 99% thinks another seminar is a good idea. With that, we will stop here. I would very much like to thank our audience who hang on to listen and to ask questions, and to also start mulling over this this complicated discussion on e-commerce regulation and IT systems. And I hope you will all join us again when we organize another follow-up seminar in the new year. I would like to thank our speakers, Frank Heijman and Han Bos from Dutch Customs. We will hopefully see you again when we do this this next seminar. We are very happy to answer your more complicated and well thought through questions at that point again. So thank you very much. Have a nice day, and hope to see you soon.